guess I'm here on the making sure we're not a complete positive selection story and tell you about cases where it might not work so well as well. Okay, so the sort of aim here is the context is a very large business plan competition in Nigeria. And so what you're wanting to do here is try and predict who's going to be a successful entrepreneur. And so the outcomes that we're going to look at are things like business survival, how much employment these businesses create, their sales and profits and things. We're going to do that 3 years later. So this is sort of something that came up in Susan's talk about whether you could quickly adapt and learn. You know, a lot of the outcomes that we care about in development take some time to transpire. So we're going to look 3 years later, see what happens. And we're going to compare three approaches of trying to see who's going to do best. We're going to look at the typical model way that we would do this in the World Bank, which would be to have judges go through, read business plans, give a score, and sort of award money on that basis. We're going to look at some sort of simple heuristic models that economists might just come up with. And then we're going to apply some machine learning methods. We're going to sort of start with 450 variables. We're going to use different machine learning methods and come up with predictions of who's going to do well. And, you know, why do we want to do this? Well, if we're an investor, we would want to see who's going to have the highest returns, learn how to invest in them. If we're governments, we might want to target these types of policies at high-growth entrepreneurs. And obviously, as researchers, we're really interested in kind of who are these types of businesses that are very different from everyone else in the country and that can grow when most firms don't ever hire employees. Okay, so this business plan competition was called You Win. It's a nice acronym for Youth Enterprise with Innovation in Nigeria. This was supposedly the world's largest business plan competition. So the first year, which is the year that I look at, they had 24,000 people apply for this competition, and they were going to choose 1,200 winners who each got $50,000. So that's $60 million in funding that's getting given out here. That we need to sort of somehow figure out who to select. And the next year got 65,000, the year after 124,000. So you're getting massive numbers of applications that you need to screen through and figure out, you know, who's going to be the successful ones. The way that this was done in practice here was 24,000 people applied online. The top 6,000, based on a very crude quick scoring, got invited to attend the business plan training, and then they submitted more detailed business plans, and then they all got scored by judges. And so what data do I have? I have data from 2,500 of these firms, so I basically have all the winners and then a selection of the losers who got to the semifinal stage or who at least had got to the stage of submitting this business plan. I have quite a lot of data from them. So I have data from the online application forms that they put in. I embedded a lot of questions on those business plans as well, where we asked them about family background, reasons for going into entrepreneurship. We measured things like Raven test scores of ability and things like that. So we've got quite a lot of data here. And then we've got these outcome measures that we might care about in terms of employment and sales and things like that. So this is a context where it's not that everybody's the same. Okay, so when we look 3 years later, there's substantial dispersion in how these guys have done. So even though we've gone through and done quite a lot of filtering to get people to the stage of applying, when we look 3 years later, a firm at the 90th percentile has 5 times the number of employees and 100 times the profits of a firm at the 10th percentile. Okay, so these guys end up different, and we'd like to know, can we predict in advance who's going to end up at one part of that distribution versus the other? Okay, so what would we do typically as a way of predicting success? We would sort of be going with these judges, and so these judges would be experts who have business experience. They look at these large business plans that people write down that have all this text and spreadsheets and things in it. They spend about 30 to 45 minutes going through each one. They've got, you know, 6,000 of these things to look through. And then they have this detailed sort of structured evaluation grid where they have scores in each of these things. So think of this as sort of evaluating, research grant proposals or student applications for PhD programs or things like that. You've got all this type of criteria, and you're going to give people a score out of 100. Okay, and these judges thought that these firms were different in advance. So there's quite a lot of dispersion in terms of the scores that they gave these firms. It wasn't that they looked at them and said, hey, we can't tell them apart. We're going to give everyone 50. You know, they're giving them quite a wide range of scores here, going from, you know, we've got firms here that have got 90 out of 100 and firms that have got 20 out of 100 on these scores, and this is after the bottom tail has already been kicked out. Okay, now how did the judges do? So this graph here shows the relationship between the judges' scores along the x-axis and then different outcomes. And so the first outcome is just whether this business is operating at all, and then we've got sales, the profits, and the employment. And basically, if anything, the firms that the judges thought were going to do better actually have less sales, are less likely to be operating, and have lower profits. Okay, so there's a slight negative correlation between what the judges thought was going to happen with these firms and what happens, but basically very low correlation there. This is for the ones that didn't win, and for the winners, it's very much the same. So even at the very top, you know, the firms, you can see massive dispersion in the scores and just very little relation with the judges. Okay, so one group of humans doesn't seem to do very well. Okay, so then, you know, well, let's put our other favorite group of humans against them, which is economists. Okay, so can we get economists to come in and say, you know, we know a little bit about these firms, we've done a lot of work on them, we can come up with models, you know, maybe we can just sort of use what we know from the literature to predict who's going to do well. Okay, so I looked at a couple of models, but you know, here's one. This is Chris Woodruff and myself, Ashant. They've done work in Ghana, and they sort of fitted a pretty ad hoc model where they just chose a bunch of characteristics that seemed to make sense from the literature. You know, we know men tend to run larger businesses than women. We know smart people might run better businesses. Education might matter. So, you know, there's basically 16 regressors, no sort of model selection criteria. Let's just bang those things in Nigeria and see how that does. So, you know, how does that do? Well, it does better than these judges. You know, there are some things that are correlated, and very simple things. You know, that female non-winners are less likely to start businesses. They run smaller firms. Age seems to matter. People in their 30s do better than people in their 20s in starting businesses. Ability matters quite a bit. This Raven test score is most important here. And then, you know, if you're trying to predict things like employment, a tech firm's going to hire less people than a sort of more labor-intensive firm. So you get some predictive power here, but it's pretty low. Okay, so then we want to see, can machine learning do any better? So, you know, we've only used this very small subset of variables, and, you know, when we come to it, then we can use machine learning and consider a much wider set of things, and particularly a wider set of things if we think there's a lot more information embedded in some of the measures that we might otherwise aggregate, right? So you do something like a Raven test, you're choosing between 8 different options on each of 12 questions, there might be information in exactly how you get a question wrong, as well as just whether you've got it right or wrong, or aggregating up the total number. Okay, so we can chuck in all these different regressors, and then, you know, we'll do this sort of standard approach. We'll have a training sample of 60% of the data, then we'll cross-validate on 20% of the data, and then we'll get predictions for the out of sample one, and we'll do 5-fold cross-validation. So, you know, this leave one out that leave a group out that Susan was talking about allows us to get predictions for everyone in our sample without using them to actually fit the model that's been used for their prediction. Okay, so what happens here? How do these machines go against the humans? This is just whether you can predict whether someone's going to survive or not. Okay, so if we just fit at a constant, 59% of them survive. This is where I showed you the judges. Business scores, you get less accuracy than just using the constant. They're slightly worse off than that. When we're using these economist models or the machine learning models, you get a slight improvement on that, but the machine learning's doing no better than the human economists here. And if we just did this simple Raven test score, just took everyone and said, okay, we're gonna give you a 5-minute test on spatial pattern recognition, you know, we're doing just as well as any of these complicated models on that. When it comes to employment, you'll see here, you know, this is mean squared error, so remember we're trying to minimize mean squared error here, that we're actually getting lower mean squared error from the Raven test score or digit span than we are from the machine learning models or from these economist models or from the judges here. And, you know, if we look at the R square here, we basically can't explain any of the variation in the data from any of these methods. And so, you know, none of these things are predicting how, you know, very well how that's going to go for the non-winners. For the winners, we get a little bit better. What you see sort of is the machine learning models, different outcomes, different models do better. And so, you know, if I put this scorecard in, so where, you know, one is the one that did the best out of these different models and seven's the one that did the worst, the Raven test on average is doing better than anything here, boosting, so one machine learning method sort of is doing reasonably well, but, you know, not much better than the two economists. The judges come next, and then two machine learning models are doing the worst. Okay, so, so obviously you can say, well, of course, you know, I don't like those machine learning models. Use my machine learning model, and I'll do slightly better. And, you know, you're welcome to chuck your favorite model at the stator and add another point to I can't predict stuff .com. So, basically none of these methods are working very well. So what's going on here? I mean, these judges, things are pretty much uncorrelated with business survival. When we start trying to look at the very top, there's a little bit of predictive power there, but basically, you know, at best, we're sort of getting from these machine learning or judges' scores, you know, maybe you can get 15 or 20% of the top 100 detected. You know, there are some things here, like this Raven test and gender and things, but, you know, in the end, we come up with a Silicon Valley model of invest in, you know, guys in their 30s who are smart. It's not a very good model, but, you know, we don't do much better than that. So it's not great for policy. You know, when it comes to machine learning, we're not sort of getting, the machines are not picking up predictors that we wouldn't think about normally as economists. When we use trees, they're not sort of getting very deep trees. They're splitting and not putting much interactions in there. And there's just very low accuracy. Okay, so what are some caveats here? Well, one is that we're having a competition here that already self-selects dramatically. So more than 50% of the sample who even apply have tertiary education versus 6% of Nigerian youth. You're actually doing a lot of the work of getting rid of the bottom tail by the way that you hold this competition and get people through. And I think what sort of some of this work suggests is it's much easier to figure out who's really bad than to figure out who's good. I mean, this is sort of the venture capital model as well. They're terrible at predicting winners, but at least they get rid of a lot of losers. Okay, so think of this as you know, like, again, admitting people to a PhD program, maybe we can get rid of a lot of people we don't want, but then we have no clue who we do want. And, you know, it's very much like that here, you know, with these investment outcomes. And so, you know, so that's one issue that, you know, but still, as I showed you, we're left with a sample of firms that have massive variation in outcomes that people thought looked really different from one another on paper, and yet there's very little correlation amongst them. So, you know, I think this might work better in other situations where you're looking at subsistence firms and you're just sort of trying to detect that low tail, and you sort of can say, you know, who's really bad versus who's a little bit bad, you know, which subsistence firms are never going to grow, versus which ones have a chance. But, you know, I think some of the development outcomes that we care about, some of these development problems, fundamentally are just really hard to predict. And, you know, even if we throw modern tools at them, you know, the essence of being an entrepreneur is you're doing risky things that are really uncertain, that are uncertain to you, that are uncertain to everyone around you. And that fundamental uncertainty is what makes an entrepreneur. And, you know, we can't overcome that, I think, with some of these tools. So that's my cold water for the day, but we'll pass on to the next person. Thanks.